yes. Receive it. Receive it. Believe it. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 I know there are so many of those that are in here in this place that are going through a lot of afflictions and a lot of complications. And we've been praying and praying and praying. And but I'm not going to stop. I can't stop because that's what the word tells us. We believe that God is a healer. And even though we may not see it at times and we may not see it immediately, but we got to believe that God is a healer. And we're going to continue because his word says so. If it has to be every Sunday, every service, we'll pray the prayer of faith. Lay hands on the sick. Anoint them with oil. We're going to continue to do so. Hallelujah. And with that being said, I want us to join together. I want us to help pray for my pastor, our bishop, Jerry Tipton. He has been diagnosed with some tumor, something cancerous around his kidney. And it is very concerning. The way his position, it could affect the other organs, the vital organs that are in his body. And he's not doing well. And so we want to go before the Lord in prayer, that God would go ahead and just intervene and touch him, and that he be made whole in the name of the Lord. Amen. If we can do that together, and for those who are here today that are needing healing, I want you to also, by faith, as you're praying for our bishop, my pastor, I want you to believe that God can heal you at the same time. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Could you do that with me right now? Father, in the name of the Lord, by the power and the authority of the name of Jesus Christ, Father, we take dominion over these sicknesses, this cancer, this tumor, Lord, this foreign object that should not be there. It was not your design, O God, but because, Lord, of what the life, the sin that we have in this world, it has brought on sickness and has brought on diseases. But Father, we know that you are the healer, and there is nothing impossible for you. And so we come together agreeing in one accord that you touch him right now, touch our dear pastor, our bishop. In Jesus' name, touch the saints that are here today who have been also afflicted for time after time. And that you, Lord, right now will intervene as they are praying for the one other one that is sick in body. I ask right now by faith, Lord, that all things shall be done according to your word, and that we stand on your word and your promises. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. If you feel like God has heard your prayer, won't you go ahead and lift your voice? Clap your hands, shout unto the Lord, give him a praise, give him a glory, give him worship in this house, and say, I believe that he is able. Come on, let Satan, let him know that you have a God that is able, that he is a liar, that he cannot convince you that God won't do the healing. Amen, somebody, hallelujah, hallelujah, praise God, it's good to have everyone here with at Capital Life Church, and those who are watching, thank you for being supportive and watching us online. Amen. Certainly, we would love to have you here if you're in the area and to join us. Amen. And be among the great family that's here at Capital Life Church. Also, I want to thank everyone who has been giving in their tithes and offerings. Amen. And we do have an offering box here that you're able to give. If you feel that the Lord has led you to give, you're more than welcome to do so here in the name of the Lord. Father, we love you. We love you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but isn't there sometimes that we just get to a place that we just get mad? Just get mad. It's not an anger that causes us to sin. Okay, the Bible does tell us that we should anger, but don't sin. Okay, but sometimes we need to be angry at some things. And we're going to talk about that here in just a little bit. But if you will open your Bibles in the book of Revelation chapter 12, we'll begin with verse 9, Revelation chapter 12, verse 9. Praise God. Revelations 12:9, if you have it, say amen. We'll read a few verses here. It says here, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore, rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knows that he hath but a short time. I want to, in these next few moments, to speak on this, the accuser of the brethren, the accuser of the brethren. You may be seated in the presence of God Almighty. It is not a surprise to anyone here, if you've been around this life of Christianity for some time, and if you have not ignored the devices and the tricks that Satan has on with the church, it's not a surprise to many of us here on the sound of my voice, and for those who are watching online, that Satan wants to stop your growth. It's a fact. I'm preaching today specifically to expose the activity of the accuser of the brethren among born-again Christians. And my goal is to see the living church delivered from the stronghold of fault-finding and to have our hearts turned instead to prayer. In an attempt to hinder, if not altogether halt, the move of God, Satan has set forth an army of fault-finding demons against the church. And the purpose of this assault is to entice the body of Christ away from the perfection of Jesus and unto the imperfections of one another. This fault finder spirit, if I may, it's assigned to assault relationships in all level. It attacks families. It attacks our churches. It attacks our relationships. It brings division into our unity. It masquerades as a discernment, that this spirit will slip into our opinions of other people, leaving us critical and judgmental. Thus, we all need to evaluate our attitude toward another. Amen. If our thoughts are on or other than faith working through love, we need to be aware that we may be under spiritual attack. And so just to help our saints here today, to let you know that you're not alone, that there is no exemption. No one is exempt from this spirit of accusation. No one is able to hide from the accuser. If it's some consolation that Christ even himself could not satisfy the quote-unquote standards of this kind of spirit when it spoke through the Pharisees. In other words, that no matter what Jesus did, the Pharisees found fault with him. That should give us some breathing room. It should give us a little more comfort to know that if Jesus couldn't get people to stop finding faults with him, understand you're going to be continuously attacked, and people and others, society, governments will continue to find fault with you. Can someone say amen? If you personally have not consulted with and listened to the individual of whom you are critical, how can you be sure that you are not fulfilling the role of the accuser of the brethren? But folks, can I just say that even the law does not judge a man unless if it first hears from him. And this is how it's written in John chapter 7, verse 51. Doth our law judge any man before it hear him and know what he doeth? In other words, the individual is still found innocent until it's proven guilty. Understand that the enemy's purpose in this assault is to discredit the minister and the saints so it can discredit the message. And this is why we should hate the accuser. As a matter of fact, it is written that the Lord himself detests or hates even more one who, and I'll just read it, one who has haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood. God hates those things, but these are the ones that he detests the most. I pray that you understand and be aware of the accuser not influencing your spirit. Because nearly every person in the church has faced the assaults of the fault finder spirit at one time or another. Everyone that has ever faced it has known the depression of trying to track down this accusing spirit as it whispers its gossips throughout the local church. Trusted friends seem distant. Established relationships are shaken, and the vision of the church is stuck in strife and in action. And as the people of God, we need to expose the weapons of the fault finder. Amen. Therefore, we cast down the accuser of the brethren. How? By learning to pray for one another instead of praying on one another. P-R-E-Y. We must learn to forgive in the same manner as Christ has forgiven us. If one has repented of his sins, we must exercise the same attitude of which that exists in heaven. We defeat the fault finder when we emulate the nature of Jesus Christ as a lamb, as the one that died for our sins, and as the priest, the one who intercedes for us. It is the accuser's job to condemn someone. If you would just imagine with me, as we enter in a court scene, we find that the accuser, Satan, the devil, the dragon, who enter in the throne before God, and it was God, who is the judge, who stood there and looked at the accuser and asked, "What have you been doing? I've been going back here and there. I've been to and fro. And one thing I've noticed, there is a man by the name of Job." Now, the only reason that subject came up is because God himself, the judge, brought Job up. And he asked the accuser and said, "Have you considered my servant Job? I know you're going to and fro making accusations, but can you find something on my servant Job?" And of course, the Satan himself, he said, "Well, I cannot, because everything is going well for him. You blessed him, and more importantly, you have put a hedge around him." Folks, can I encourage someone here under the sound of my voice that once God has a hedge around you, there is no demon in hell, even Satan himself, cannot penetrate the power and the might of God over your life. Can I simply say that once God gives you an anointing, that anointing breaks the yoke. The anointing breaks strongholds where the enemy and his fiery darts cannot penetrate, where his accusations cannot fit into this arena. Can I just encourage somebody to stay faithful unto God and his righteousness, to stand before the Lord and say that if God be for me, who can come against me? And watch the accusers stand on the outside of the court and only watch what's happening in your life in the inside while you are in the hand of God. But sometimes that hedge is removed. In this case, the hedge was removed over Job's life because God wanted to prove a point that Satan cannot figure out man the way he thinks he can figure out man. He thinks he can give certain pressure points to each individual and trigger them to do things that are contrary to the things of God. But every time that Satan pressed some triggers over Job's life, it took his family, it took his goods, it broke in the relationship between his wife and the marriage. His friends let him down. Am I talking to somebody here under the sound of my voice? You feel like things are just collapsing. You think things are falling apart. And this is where the accuser now comes into the scene and now makes some accusations to remind you that you are a sinner, to remind you that you are nobody, to remind you that God does not love you and does not care about you, and that you deserve to die, and that there is no more hope for you, and that there is nothing else that can help you through your situation. This is what the accuser will do. But can I give you some good news? In that same court scene, there is a Jesus who is our advocate before God, the Father. I don't know about you. If you don't understand what I'm saying, when I mean by advocate, I'm saying that we have a lawyer, a defender, hallelujah, that will be on your side to stand before the court and proclaim, hallelujah, to defend who you are. And this is how 1 John says it. He says, my little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Jesus is also calls the Holy Spirit, or the Spirit, and the Bible says that it's our advocate in many verses. And you can find that in the book of John, chapter 14, 15, and 16. So even when we are guilty of sinning, if we have surrendered to Jesus Christ and confess him as our Lord, our lives, and he is our advocate before the Father. Understand that his sacrifice for our sins was good once and for all. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says, For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Thank God. Thank Jesus that we can declare not guilty before God the judge. I wish somebody would get excited right now that when the accuser begins to whisper that it is your fault, he finds fault in your life. He makes you feel guilty. Hallelujah. He makes you feel like there is no hope. And if he can tear down that spirit, if he can tear down that glimpse of hope, he's got you. But thank Jesus Christ that he can say not guilty, because that he is our advocate. He is our lawyer, our defender. That's why maybe David said that he is my shield, my buckler, my strong tower. I don't know how that makes you feel, but I could go before the court with my head up and look at the face of the accuser and say, I got an advocate who can help me through this. Now, let me just clarify something here that I want people to understand, that this does not mean that once we have been saved, we've always saved. Hallelujah. And I'm not preaching that kind of preaching here. You have to understand, we got to understand that we can't fall and we can lose out. But we do understand, though, that we have an advocate that we can come before and repent of our sins. So that's what the Bible says. We all require to confess our sins to the Lord. You see, that this shows that we have a humble and repentant heart, and that we don't have to take his sacrifice for granted. Maybe this is why the psalmist says here, a broken and contrite heart, O God, that you will not despise. Say, we have a promise. You see, we have this promise. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Jesus is our perfect advocate because He lived here on earth as a human man. He has compassion on every struggle because He also experienced rejection, experienced temptation, experienced abuse, and experienced the unfair treatment. Hello, somebody. Am I preaching to someone here today? Jesus lived a perfect life on earth, which qualified Him to forever be our high priest and advocate. And unlike a human advocate who has knowledge based exclusively on external circumstances, we have a heavenly advocate who can also see the internal condition of our hearts. I'm not preaching long on this message. I just want to make my point here today. Understand that Jesus purchased us with His blood. He is our Lord, our Savior, and our perfect advocate. And because of Him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption. This was the plan from before the beginning of the world, and Jesus will be our advocate until we are with Him in heaven. Come on, let's all stand. I told you this is going to be short. I know it's blowing your mind. I think I broke a record here. What am I getting at, church? I'm getting at is this. Doesn't it seem like every time we feel like we're finally getting some ground, we're finally getting ahead, and all of a sudden, all hell breaks loose? It seems like every time we seem like we're getting a revival, something begins to happen. There is a breakdown. There are troubles. There are sicknesses. There are pains. There are arguments. There are separations. There are disunity. There is a numerous things that come every time when we get a breakthrough, or just about getting a breakthrough. All of a sudden, there comes the accuser. His job is simply to remind you, that you are still yet a sinner, and that what you're doing is a waste of time, and that you're never going to get ahead. I'm talking to somebody here today. You've been fighting, you've been struggling, you've been right now battling, deciding, should I stay or should I go? Should I hold on or should I let go? You know, I don't really, can Pastor just be a little bit transparent here today? I sit and wrestle with God, and I tell Him, I said, Lord, we've been praying for these that have been sick in body, and I know, and I've talked about this last week a little bit. But I just want to let you know I'm just as human as you are, and I at times have to deal with the accuser that comes whispering into my ears. But I will have to say that there are moments that I question God and said, when are you going to finally give us that breakthrough that we've been looking for? Can it happen? Will it happen? I know it sounds like there's a moment of doubt, and I'm just as human as you are, folks. I'm not Mr. Spiritual, that where I'm so heavenly minded that I can't think about what's going on here on earth. I bleed just like you bleed, and I wrestle with God. When I found myself and then what God has revealed to me, He said, listen, be very, very careful that you're not taking advice from the accuser. Do Just remember that your life is always on trial. The accuser of the brethren will be in the court scene with you until the day you die. What am I saying? I'm saying is that I want you to be aware that while, yes, there is an accuser, but understand in the same courtroom, there is an advocate. You know, they tell you that if you have been arrested, if you have been taken into custody, and for reasons or whatever it may be, you ending up that you may have to go to court. One of the questions they ask you and they tell you that if you do not have a lawyer, you can seek the district attorney to help you. And some decide not to go, or should I say they go into court without a lawyer, and they try to defend themselves. I'm preaching to someone here right now. Too many times we've been accused of something, and all you've been doing is trying to defend yourself without an advocate. And I'm going to tell you, you're always going to lose against the accuser. You understand that the accuser has every right to accuse you of who you are, because we've all been born into sin, and we all have the rights to die because of our sins. But if the accuser can cover up the hope of glory, if he can cover up the cross, if he can just stop the flow of the blood that has been shed on Calvary for our iniquities and our transgressions, if he can hide that from you, and all that's left in the courtroom is you and the accuser, I'm going to tell you, you're going to lose that battle every single time. I want to give someone hope here today that while there is an accuser, you can have an advocate that will be there to defend you. And I'll finish with this. Interesting to note that when Jesus was apprehended at the Garden of Gethsemane, it was the disciples who was by his side after Judas gave him that kiss, a betrayal. And as soon as they apprehended Jesus, it was Peter who drew his sword and cut off the ear of the one soldier. And of course, Jesus says to Peter, put away that sword, for those who live by the sword will die by the sword. Technically, Peter needed to be arrested. Technically, Peter needed to go to a court because he had done an offense. He attacked a soldier. But right there beside Peter, and Peter didn't even know it, that he had an advocate with him. And what Jesus did next astonished everyone. He took the ear that was cut off from the soldier. He picked it up and put it right back on the man's head. And then next thing you knew it was that the ear was back on his head. What Jesus just did was incredible. Because now that while the accuser had something to accuse Peter of, there was some evidence that was there because the ear was cut off there laying on the ground. There was proof that there was blood all over this man, and he had no ear. It was easy. It was a closed case, shut case, for Peter to be in prison and then, of course, put to death. But because there was an advocate who took the ear and put it right back into the man's head, now the accuser have no testimony, doesn't have any evidence to prove what Peter did. Don't you understand that when you are washed by the blood of Jesus Christ, the Bible says that all those sins are now washed away and have been taken and thrown into the deep of the sea of forgetfulness. He's taken all the evidence and threw it all out the window, where the accuser has nothing to now accuse you of, because you have been washed. All the evidence is gone. Am I helping somebody here today? I wonder if every eye's closed in this building, because I know every one of us have gone through where the accuser has whispered in their ear, in your ear, and said some things to get you into a place of depression, get you to a place of where you started to doubt that God can, get you to a place to where you deserve to die, got to you to a place that you should just give up, surrender, might as well forget about it. I'm here to tell somebody that your advocate is here today with you by your side, and he is here to defend you and guide you and protect you. I want to encourage someone here, because you've been afflicted with this for some time, and God wants to deliver you from this because God has a plan and a purpose in your life. Folks, can I just say that this accuser, this, what the Bible says, is the great dragon, the old serpent, the devil. He said that it was here to deceive the whole world, and that he was here to kill, to steal, and destroy. But here comes a time that his time would end, that he would be thrown into the pit, and he will be chained up forever and ever. I don't know about you, but I'm looking for that blessed hope, the hope of glory. And I'm here about to go in rejoicing as I enter heaven, because he paid a price for my sins. And I don't have to listen and respond to the accuser. As a matter of fact, it's always wise that when you are in the court, as you that have been accused, it is wise for you not to stand on the seat or sit at the seat. It's best that the Lord handles it. This is where we need Jesus Christ to handle our sins. Let him deal with it. How many are glad that we have an advocate? And every eye is closed in this building, I want you to, if you make your way out of your seats and join me in prayer, that you are thankful that even though that there is an accuser in your life, here to destroy you, to hurt you, to lie to you, to deceive you, but you got an advocate. You got a lawyer who loves you. You got a lawyer who will defend you. He said, I will never leave thee or forsake thee. He said, I will be with you until the end of the world. I'm here to encourage somebody. I'm here to preach to you today that God, Jesus Christ himself, is here to be by your side and to help you out and lift you up Come on, as they worship and song, I wonder if anybody here will be seeking God's face. And if you are the one here today, ma'am, if you're the one here today, sir, who has struggled, and allow the accuser to speak into your spirit. And let me assure you again that the Lamb of God here today, who has shed his blood, hallelujah, has become your advocate. And that's why the Bible says, that's why the word says that we are the overcomers. And how? It's by the word of our testimony.
When my broken heart was healed in the palm.
Come on, somebody, let's pray. Understand that you can make it. That you're going to make it.
My past was silent.
God wants, or the accuser wants to blame you. He wants to put the finger on you to say it's your fault. It's all about you, that you're not going to make it. But Jesus is here today for you, folks. He's here to defend you. He's here to cover you. He's here to lift you up. If you're here today wanting that, I want you to lift your hands in the name of the Lord. Yes, Lord.
When you made your blood and my pain collide, beautiful love, you are my king. You are the one, my everything.
You're my everything. My God, my God.
You are the one, my everything. Now I run to you, 'cause you are all I need.
If you're here today, I wonder if you would say, Pastor, pray for me. I want you to pray for me. I've been struggling with my faith. I've been struggling with my walk with God. I've allowed the guilt to just consume me.
That day
I allow these things to overwhelm me. But I'm here to help you today by the power of the Holy Ghost. That God can help you through this. He can deliver you.
Oh, you just
come and say, Pastor, I want you to pray for me.
Death.
The one who cares. Folks, we got a baptism here right now. Our little dear Jessie Castillo, she's going to get baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. We're going to see a court scene take place. We're going to see the accuser, but now that because of her faith and believing in Jesus Christ, she called upon an advocate. And her prayer is that this advocate will help her through this court scene, that she be forgiven of her sins. And let me tell you, the accuser is going to continue to find every evidence he can find, everything that he can find to dismiss the opportunity for her liberty, for her freedom. But there is an advocate and said, don't you worry about a thing, because I'm about to wash it all away. And so I want you to take some time before you leave to join us as we celebrate this moment, as she's getting prepared, as we witness a baptism, a new birth experience, someone who has repented of their sins and had their sins all washed away. And if you're here, if you've never been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, today is your day. Amen. Don't leave this place with a wishing and hoping, I could have, I should have. This is your moment. This is the day that the Lord has made. God is making us able for you today to do so. And just take a step out of faith and belief. God wants to be your advocate. He wants to be there for you. And if you're here today, if you want to get baptized in Jesus' name, you can do that today. Hallelujah. As they continue to worship, hallelujah, as we're getting prepared to go for this baptism. And also, before you dismiss, there is some refreshments that you can enjoy, especially if our guests that are here today. I would love to meet with you right after service. And we can take some time to drink some coffee or for refreshments and some pastries that we have made available for you. God bless you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. Jesus.